Two-factor authentication. It is not as complicated as you think. Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. Here are some myths that I hear regularly, and I've heard regularly for years, about two-factor authentication that I think are getting in the way of people's adoption of the technology. You mean I have to do this every time I sign in? If someone gets my second factor, does that mean they can just waltz into my account? If I lose my second factor, doesn't that mean I'm locked out forever? Can't a second factor be faked or spoofed or intercepted, and doesn't that make it worthless? I don't have or want a mobile phone, so I can't use two-factor. There's a lot of misinformation around two-factor authentication. The problem is that this can lead people to avoid it, even though it is one of the single most effective ways of securing your online account. I want to clear up some of the myths around two-factor authentication. It's not nearly as confusing or as scary or as complicated as you might think it is. Now, first we have to define what we mean by two-factor authentication. Sometimes we refer to it as 2FA, multi-factor authentication, MFA. Traditionally, you sign into an online account with a username and a password. These are things that you know. By keeping the password part of that secret, it's your ability to provide it that theoretically proves you are you and should be allowed into the account. A second factor is typically something you have. So, for example, after it's been set up, after entering your username and password, you might be asked to prove you have access to your mobile device by entering a code that was sent to it. Now, I'll discuss other forms of 2FA. Not all of them require a mobile device. Your ability to provide that code that was sent to your device proves that you are in possession of that physical device, your second factor. Two factors: something you know, your password, and something you have, your device. Now, requiring that second factor adds security, because even if a hacker somehow learns your password, they still can't get into your account because they don't have your second factor. All right, it's not every time. Two-factor authentication is used only once, the first time you sign into an account on your computer. After that, that device becomes trusted, and signing in again later requires only your password, just like before. Now, I had to put once in quotes because, of course, it's never quite that simple. Two-factor might kick in the first time you sign in using a different browser, the first time you sign in on a different machine, the first time you sign in after clearing cookies, after some length of time defined by the service that you're signing into, maybe 30 or 90 or 180 days. If the service you're signing in detects suspicious activity on your account, they may require two-factor authentication. All of these are rare, though. So in practice, you'll need to use two-factor only occasionally, and most certainly not every time you need to sign in. Now, what's neat about this is that every sign-in from a hacker meets that first time you sign in on a different browser machine criteria. Thus, they'll always be required to provide your second factor, which they don't have. Now, that second factor, it's not enough on its own, right? Remember, it's two-factor authentication. You need both your password and your second factor to sign in that first time. That means that having your second factor fall into the hands of a hacker is an issue only if they also know your password. That people that might find or steal your second factor are rarely the same people who might gain access to your password. The former, of course, needs to be close enough to actually get the hands on the factor. The latter, well, they're typically overseas working their scams. If you lose your second factor, you can quickly disconnect it from your account by signing into the account and turning it off or changing that existing two-factor configuration. Now, losing your second factor, it's an inconvenience, not a disaster. You will not be locked out of your account. There are two safety nets in place, a third actually if you take an additional step. First, backup codes. When you set up two-factor for an account, you'll be prompted to create and or save a set of backup codes. These codes can be used once each in place of your second factor. Once you sign in, then you can temporarily turn off 2FA or you can change it to a replacement device. The backup codes, of course, need to be stored securely, but as long as they're accessible to you, you can always get back into your account. Second, account recovery. Services may also use account recovery techniques, meaning the I forgot my password path, to confirm that you are who you say you are without necessarily needing your second factor. They may send an email message to an associated recovery account or a text message to a different recovery phone number or any of several other pre-configured recovery options. After having you jump through those additional hoops, then the service may accept your sign-in, again, without that second factor. Now, this doesn't invalidate 2FA, because a hacker would have had to have jumped through all those hoops as well, which is extremely unlikely. Your ability to do so proves you are you. All right, the other approach is something you can add, and that's a second factor. It's common when using hardware keys as two-factor authentication. You set up one key, and then you set up a second one and keep the second one in a safe place. In that same vein, you could set up both SMS and app-based 2FA such that either could be used in the event the other is lost. In all of these cases, and as long as you prepare, which most services are going to force you to do, losing your second factor is an inconvenience at worst. Now, there's no such thing as perfect security, period. That means that, yes, it is possible for hackers to spoof or bypass two-factor authentication in some situations. The two most common are that mobile numbers can be stolen, also known as SIM swapping, which redirects all the SMS messages to the hacker. Or successful phishing attacks can intercept two-factor codes that you're providing in real time. I say most common, but in reality, they're both rare and preventable. The first, of course, requires that you need to be individually targeted, and you can set up a PIN with your mobile provider to prevent unauthorized reassignment. For the second, you can pay close attention to signs of phishing to avoid being lured down that path. Neither of these scenarios are arguments against 2FA. Any two-factor authentication is better than no two-factor authentication. By using two-factor authentication, you're stacking the odds in your favor, making it significantly less likely that your account will be compromised. All right, about those second factors. We've talked about mobile devices. In fact, I held up my phone. You don't always need one. It varies depending on the online provider with which you are setting up two-factor authentication, but there are a variety of devices that can be used. Smartphones can run an app, a time-based one-time password two-factor authentication app, or they can also run service-specific authentication apps, like maybe a Microsoft app for Microsoft authentication or a Google app for Google authentication. You can have a plain old flip phone, mobile phone, to receive SMS text messages. Sometimes you might be able to do this with any phone, including a landline, to receive codes via an automated voice. Unfortunately, before we get too excited, this turns out to be really rare, which is unfortunate. It could be an email address unrelated to the account using 2FA. Your ability to receive a code, for example, at a specific pre-configured email address could act as a second factor. Hardware keys, such as the YubiKey, can act as a second factor. Any other device already signed into the account that can present a, is this you signing in on that other device? That can be a second factor. Your device's camera or fingerprint reader can also act as a second factor. I've seen each of these act as second factors on various services. Again, which ones will be available on which service depends on the service you're configuring. All right, why bother with all this? Well, to be clear, it's really very little bother. After you set it up, The only thing that really changes is that the first time you sign into a new device or browser, you'll need your second factor. After that, it's the same sign-in process as before. Here's the thing. Password-based compromise happens constantly. Be it bad passwords, which of course I know doesn't apply to you, malware, brute force, breaches, or some other forms of compromise, accounts are getting hacked into often. Two-factor stops 99% of these attempts dead in their tracks. It really is a matter of peace of mind. So, please, take a few minutes right now and set up two-factor authentication on every account you have that supports it. Start with your password manager, your email accounts, your financial accounts, and any social media that you might have. Take care to follow the instructions carefully and create and save the backup codes you'll be instructed to set up. Seriously, a few minutes today could save you a giant headache in the future. For updates, for comments, for links related to this topic and more, visit askleo.com/181875. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.